This is another Wednesday night message on prayer, and our desire is that we all can get into God's word and add some quality to our prayers, but also when we pray for one another, this is what it's focused on, and quite frankly, if you're praying for me or anyone, especially, you know, someone you in the body of Christ, as we pray for one another, these are some things we need to make sure that we're praying for and understanding what we're saying when we pray for it. So we're going to be looking at an area of scripture. I know I spoke on it many times before, but this time we're going to ruminate and kind of digest it little by little. I sort of went down a little rabbit hole of terms and when we talk about this area of prayer. So with that being said, I want to just read the key verse and then have a word of prayer. I start with a verse from Ephesians chapter 3, verses 14 through 19, but I'll just read verse 16 is where we're going to be looking at tonight. Starting at verse 16, that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with the might by his spirit in the inner man. Father, we ask for wisdom and grace in your word as we study the prayer that Paul asked the Ephesians to pray for. And as he explains how he's praying for them, may we likewise pray for one another. And we thank you for this lesson. For us in the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Yes, this is an area actually that when we pray for the saints, a lot of these scriptures are actually for the inspirational part of scripture that we read before we pray for the saints. But now we're going to just look at and dissect various verses in this area of scripture. I'm going to read the whole thing and then we're going to back up and go to one verse. The whole area of scripture starts at verse 14 and goes down to verse 19. And I'll start at 14. He says, for this cause I bow my knee unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with the might by his spirit in the inner man. That Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height, and to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, that ye might be filled with all the fullness of God. That's saying a lot, but it really paints and gives us a good makeup of the power of our prayer, the quality of our prayer, the objective of our prayer, and also what God has in store for us that we petitioning him for in this area of scripture. But we're going to back up just a little to go to verse 16. Now, this message shouldn't be long because we're going to look at verse 16 and believe it or not, I think it's the first phrase that we're going to be looking at. So we're talking about digesting something very slowly, very meticulously at the beginning. Now, starting at verse 16, it says that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might by his spirit in the inner man. Look at the first phrase. It says that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory. Maybe it's two phrases. Let's look at this. But first of all, that he would grant. That word grant means to allow. He will allow and give. Paul is saying, I'm praying for you, but I'm praying that the Lord will allow and give you something. It's going to be very special what he's going to give. We want him to give. Again, he's not praying this for himself. He's praying this for the other believers in Ephesians. Now, that wouldn't be just for the Ephesians. Anyone he prays for, anyone we pray for. Matter of fact, if you're praying for me, I would love to have you apply what Paul is saying in this verse of scripture. We know we pray for the leaders. We pray for the needs of various saints. We have a list of all the saints' names that we pray over. This is what we should focus on in the quality of our prayers, that we want God to intervene. And to tell you the truth, I know saints have various particular problems, but when we cover this area of scripture, we cover spiritually it all. We cover it all. Now, what are we saying? Let's go back. Now, we want him to allow and give us something in verse 16. Well, when we read the first part, it says that he would grant you. I want the Lord to grant you this. Paul wanted the saints in the Ephesians to be granted this. Matter of fact, Corinth, any other place, the Philippi, the Philippians, any place in Rome, everywhere there's a believer. He wanted God to give them something. Now, let's look at the first thing he wants to give. If you look at that verse 16, the second thing, what is it? According to the riches of his glory. Say that one more time. According to the riches of his glory. I don't know if we realize just how powerful that is. According to the riches of his glory. Riches, we think about, he wants to, according to God's riches. Now, when we think about riches, first thing we say, this person is a rich person. They're very rich. Usually we refer to they got a lot of money. But this, when we describe riches in this category, God, does God really need money? Is that what we value his riches, being rich in? No, because everything in this world belongs to him. Matter of fact, anybody that's here, I don't care if you have mansions or anything, you're just renting. I don't care what kind of cars you have, boats, I don't care how many yachts you have. I don't care how many acres of land you have. Some people have several islands they particularly own according to what's here on this earth. But technically, it all belongs to God. They are renting. And when you say rent, you say, well, I don't pay God anything. No, you're living. God gave you that, the ability to breathe and to live. Because you have access to these resources, we would consider that person rich. But God has all, every entity that is in this earth belongs to him, his resources. Now, if we limit his resources only to what's here on this earth, he would be sort of a very limited God. But he's not limited. He is a God that has all the resources in the whole universe and earth, heaven and earth. That's the resources God has. And that means he has control. He has access and he can share all of those resources to whomever. And especially if you're in the family of God. When Paul is saying, for these Ephesians, that he wants him to a grant or share according to what God has in his riches, that's unlimited. According to his riches. Now, God has all the riches there is to have, but he didn't spoil us, does it? We've seen spoiled people or spoiled kids. They're not nice to be around. They just get everything they want, anything they whine for, cry for, and they're not good people to be around. Spoiled people. God didn't spoil us, but he will sure give us what we need. But we need to pray that God will release those riches. Sometimes individuals block by their prayers because of obstacles. Now, we talked a lot about what can block our prayers. Could be sin in our life. It could be lack of connection with God. But then that means that someone else has got to stand in the gap for you, okay? You may be short in your prayers, but someone else, maybe they're up on their prayers, but they're saying, God, share these riches with that individual. Share what you have for this person's life. Same thing that Paul was praying for the Ephesians. I'm praying that he will grant you. He would share and pass on these riches. Now, there's a couple of other scriptures. This is not the only place that talks about riches. Of course, there are more, but this is where you kind of go down the rabbit hole. I'm only going to go to three different scriptures, and that's going to be it because, again, we're picking it apart slowly, and we're going to look at three things about these riches and in Christ and what is according to God. The first one is in Ephesians 1:7. Believe it or not, two of them are in Ephesians. One is in Philippians, but if you turn with me to Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7. Ephesians 1:7. And that reads, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace. Now, we're talking about the resources and the riches, not the money. Grace does not need money, but his grace. Unmerited favor. He's given grace. We're praying that a person gets grace. We didn't say that, oh Lord, they've done so well, you ought to give them this. No, they may not deserve it, but they need grace. Matter of fact, anytime we pray for a person we know that needs Christ as their Lord and Savior, that's what we're praying for, that the grace of God will be upon them to allow them, give them the chance to accept him as their Lord and Savior. Now, let's look at it again. In whom we have redemption through his blood. How can they be redeemed? Well, one of the resources and riches of God is the blood of Jesus and the power and what that represents and what that accomplishes in our lives. The reason why we are saved and know Christ is because of that rich blood of Christ that was shed. He shed for the lost. Jesus came to seek and to save that which was lost. And so his blood was shed for that. We are saved by the blood, his blood. He didn't say, go out here and cut your arm and bleed and then, okay, now you're saved. No, someone has done that. And that is Christ. He's died, shed his blood. And with that comes redemption, means redeeming, buying back something that was lost or no good. Now, not only that, but if you look at that verse 7, it says, the forgiveness of sin. Now, that's rich too. Forgive a person of their sins. Many people want other people to forgive them, which in a sense is okay, but sometimes people just can't. So they say, well, I'm lost because I can't get the forgiveness of that person. In God's case, he has a rich grace. That means you go to him and he has rich grace and he can forgive a sin. He'll forgive it. Don't worry about the other persons. We live our lives, we've done things and sinned against not only God, but other people. And that doesn't mean that it's left to that. That's how rich God is. I got enough to cover your sins. But it says according to the what? Riches. And that means according to the ability that God has in his riches. Again, we already said it's unlimited, everything. And even forgiveness of sin, that's part of his resources. Something to God. People can't go out here and buy that. People try to. I've heard of mobsters and all of them putting money in the church and say, well, that'll cover my sins. It doesn't work like that. That's man's babble of trying to deal with sins. But God has a rich source. They don't see, that's the source they need to go to. When you go to the source and stand on what the blood of Jesus has done, you have forgiveness of sins. According to his riches, there's the word riches again, and grace. Now, there's another verse, Ephesians chapter 2, verses 4. Ephesians 2, 4. And that reads, but God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us. Talking about some more riches. Now this reading that verse, that's just some of it, you know. But when we look at it, this is a blessing. That when we pray for another person and someone is praying for us in this manner, this is truly a blessing. When he's praying for the Ephesians, he set an objective and a model for excellent prayer for other believers. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 4, but God, who is, there's the word again, rich in mercy. He has the riches and ability to have unlimited resources in what? Mercy. Mercy. Mercy is not getting what you do deserve. Grace is getting what you haven't done anything to get. And what we do deserve really is punishment according to the word. The soul that sins shall die. The wages of sin is death. And that's what you're supposed to, that's what it costs for sin. It causes death. But he says, now I got some mercy that can cover that. In other words, the only way to pay for your sins is something has to die. But he has something that can give you mercy for it and take care of it. And where does it come from? We know it comes from what Jesus Christ and his blood has accomplished, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. So then his mercy, it grants that kind of mercy, not getting what we do deserve, for his great what? The reason why he's doing it. Now, this is something, again, everyone is out. Most people want someone either to say to them, show to them, and make them feel like they have, is love. Now, God has done all of those. He's done every last one. If you want him to show it, explain it, prove it, he's done that. But people in the world will say, but I don't want that. I want love from somebody else. I want somebody else to give me this love. And to tell you the truth, that's going to... That's petty. That means that's something that doesn't really cut it. You think that will satisfy you? Matter of fact, it doesn't last. We've been studying, we'll be studying about the love of God. No one can separate it. You know, people who love you can sometimes all of a sudden don't love you anymore or find somebody else they want to love. But not Christ, not God. God says, yeah, I love you with an everlasting love. That means it has no end. But we're talking about now a rich mercy. Merciful. You may not have been merciful, but he's going to show mercy. Not only that, he's going to do it in great love. And wherewith in he loved us. He loved us how? He gave his only begotten son. Now, if a person gives their child for you to pay for something that you deserve to actually do, but they're going to pay, but they didn't pay with money. They didn't pay with land or gold or any other resource. They paid for something that's more precious. You ask any mother or father who has children. I often said, I had an aunt that had seven boys, but when she looked at that and God gave his only son, she said, I got seven, and I couldn't give any one of them up, not to pay for somebody's sin. And he ain't had but one. It ain't like he had a couple of more to go with. That meant a lot. That's how much he loved us. But he's rich with it. Amen? So that's what we're praying for. God, give them the love that they need. Pray for me that God will give me the love that I need. Now, Philippians 4:19. Last one. We're going to stop there. It says, but my God shall supply all your needs. Now, this is a familiar scripture, isn't it? Philippians 4:19. But my God shall supply all your needs according to the riches of his glory. How is he going to do it? By Christ Jesus. What we're praying for is for God to do something for others that he's rich with. And he has the power and ability to do it because it comes through Christ Jesus. When we pray in the name of Christ. When we're asking for his riches to be shared and given to others that we pray for, it's according to Christ. And we can thank the Lord for it. We're not saying, Lord, I'm going to buy a little bit of mercy and grace and love and forgiveness of all these, and I'll buy some of your riches. It's not us trying to get some of them, hold on to it and say we're going to divvy it out to somebody like we do things in our life. No, we're saying, God, you got it. You have it. And because of Christ, I'm asking you to benefit those that are in need, especially the brothers and sisters in Christ. And even any lost soul that we know, when we pray for the lost, we're praying for this. So yes, prayer is, this is a one small bit. This is only the first two phrases of verse 16. And look how much more God can give when we study this area of scripture. So I'm going to stop there. This is enough for anybody to ruminate on. And I do pray that you would do this. And I pray for anyone that's listening to this broadcast, that they would give their heart and life to Christ, because what he's praying for is something that you can have and you can also do for others, but you don't have the power for that, but God does. And you can obtain it initially by asking him to come into your heart and life, to be your Lord and Savior, to save you. You know, in an airplane, one of the first things when they give instructions when you're flying, and they say, if you have to use your oxygen, if it comes down, even if you have children or someone else with you, they said, don't put the oxygen on them first. Put it on yourself. Why? Because if you pass out, you can't help the next one. But if you take what God, the oxygen and the life and the spiritual life that God has, you put that on for yourself, and then you can take care of others. So this is what he's asking you to do. Take his life so that you can share it with others. You can't share what you don't have. You know your heart, but you can make it right. Just pray this prayer. Dear God, I'm a sinner, and I'm sorry for my sins. And I want Jesus to come into my heart and life, to be my Lord and Savior from sin. Come into my heart, Lord Jesus, and born me into your family. Help me to live my life from this day forth by your power and your might. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. If you prayed that prayer and you meant it with all your heart, you had at the initial grant of the riches of God and His grace, you have access to what God has. It won't be for yourself, it's that you can share with others. So if you prayed that prayer, write to us and let us know that you made that decision. You can write to the address at the end of this broadcast. And in the meantime, while we're waiting for the next Wednesday message, and as you're working on your spiritual life and prayer, remember what Jesus said in John 10:10b, I am come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly. Be blessed.